classic Aspen executive seminar in Ukraine. And the main challenge to do that was to find moderators experienced in our seminar who could speak and conduct the seminar in Russian. But we did that, we found the texts, and we spent 2 years with his funding doing seminars for a cross-section of remarkable young Ukrainians. And after that, the funding stopped, and I was back here, and I really didn't know whether it was continuing. And then, just about a year and a half ago, and is Anatoly Klopotsky here? I think he is in the back. He came to see me and explained that the seminar had gone viral, that young people across business, civil society, government, and the media had become so excited about this seminar that they were funding it themselves. The alumni of the seminar were funding it themselves. It was nothing like it in Ukraine for young people to talk together, to get together and talk about the good society and what could Ukraine be like. So I went back and I realized, and I met these people, that the alumni of the Aspen group, and they actually call themselves Aspen Ukraine or the Aspen Ukraine alumni, are now a cross-section grossly disproportionately represented in the new government in Ukraine. And it is extraordinarily exciting for us to see. And then, flash forward, when Tom Friedman, who needs no introduction, was in Ukraine, and he's been there, of course, a number of times, and he wanted to meet with some of the new voices, the people in the generation who were going to be leading a new Ukraine, he ended up meeting with the alumni of the Aspen program in Ukraine. He sent an email to us, and of course his wife Anne, who is one of the Aspen Institute trustees, saying essentially, you should be incredibly proud of the Aspen people in Ukraine. And I wrote to Tom, who was probably in the Middle East by the time I got returned his email, and I said, well, what if we were to bring over two of the alumni of the Aspen experience in Ukraine to the Ideas Festival? And he said it would be a terrific idea, and that if we did so, he would moderate the discussion. So here we are today with two of the Aspen Ukraine alumni and Tom Friedman to engage in a discussion about Ukraine today and tomorrow. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Elliot, thank you very much. I think I said I would insist on being able to interview him. It's a great opportunity. And welcome all. You know, Ukraine has not, I don't think, historically been on the agenda of the Ideas Festival. And so it's a real opportunity, I think, for us to learn more about you and what's going on. And Viktoria and Vitaliy, I wondered if you could just begin by introducing yourselves. Tell us, you know, how you got involved in the Maidan movement and what you're doing now, and then we'll jump into the substance. Viktoria, why don't you start?
So at first, I really happy to be here because Aspen is a very important part of my life. It's really true that seminars in Ukraine, it was something great for us because it's a new idea, it's a new people and a new communication. We are colleagues, actually. So I was a journalist. Also, I was a civil society activist and media expert. Before Maidan,
tell people what the Maidan is, those who don't.
Maidan is a big square in the center of the capital of Ukraine. So, but traditionally on Maidan happens all revolution in Ukraine, so, because it's a very comfortable place for this, you know. And it was our idea, because I was one of the organizers, the first step to Maidan. It named Students Maidan. It was the Maidan after when Viktor Yanukovych refused the sign agreements with EU, and not politician, but only civil society activists and journalists were the organizers this first period of Maidan, because you know, the politician in Ukraine, we have some problem with trust to traditional politicians.
It's pretty nice.
Then I was the member of the Council of Maidan. It was the body which managed all processes of Maidan. After that, I became the deputy secretary of the National Council of Security, and informational security is one, it was my sphere. So I know very good the Russian propaganda, for example, and Ukrainian media also. Now I am advisor of the Speaker of Parliament, Alexander Turchinov, who was the president of Ukraine all these very difficult 3 months. And also, I'm one of the founder of the party of Maidan. So it's a new party with a new people who came after Maidan in Ukraine politics.
Great. And just to an instant history for people who don't know, a year ago, roughly, Viktor Yanukovych and the president refused to sign the EU-Ukraine Association Agreement. That then triggered the Maidan movement. And I had a chance to meet Vitaly when I was in Kiev, and Vitaly, please introduce yourself.
Yeah. First of all, I've been hoping to interview Thomas Friedman for my magazine for a while, and now he's actually interviewing me and my colleagues, so that's a nice little development. Let me start with a little personal touch with what's been going on in Kiev, so you can get a better understanding. Exactly a year ago, my life and life of my family has turned into switched into an emergency mode. I was on holiday in Croatia with my wife. I was then chief editor of Ukraine's largest weekly magazine called Correspondent, and the site, when the co-owner of the magazine named Boris called me and said that he's gonna fly over to Croatia to tell me some important news. I immediately understood that, you know, owners of the magazines don't normally fly to chief editors on vacation to tell him something.
To give you a raise.
Right. So obviously, he flew in to tell me that he's selling the magazine, that he was under extreme pressure from the presidential administration. He could take it no longer, and he's got an attractive financial offer from the businessman close to the president. So I immediately understood that I would probably have to leave the magazine soon, because the people taking over the magazine, their values, if they have any, are barely compatible with mine or with free media at all. So we got back, the new people took over, and as I feared, they immediately introduced censorship, a complete ban on criticizing the government, the president. So as probably any person in this editorial would do, I quit immediately, and a lot of journalists followed suit. So we pretty much went nowhere, because at that point, it wasn't clear how long Yanukovych is going to last, like 3 years, 5 years, maybe 12 years. But we did so because I think it was any normal person would do. Then Maidan started in about a month. And I don't actually think it started with the Maidan, with Yanukovych's failure to sign the EU. It actually started 2 days afterwards, when the students decided to stay overnight on Maidan and were brutally attacked by riot police. That's when the whole thing started. That's when the pro-European rally turned into a revolution of dignity, right? And lasted for about a month or so peacefully. Then it suddenly turned violent, and people started disappearing. Some of them were kidnapped, taken to the woods, and tortured. One of them was my former business editor, Igor Lutsenko. He disappeared. Then he reappeared in 3 days on TV in a wheelchair. He was obviously tortured, but he was let free. The other guy who was there with him, he was killed, and he was found dead a few days afterwards. So then that was going on for about a couple of weeks. We were, of course, physically present at the Maidan and supporting it financially and being there all the time. Victoria has been there. And then one morning when we woke up and figured that about 15 people went missing over the last night, my wife told me, look, we probably got to pack and leave the city, because it's not clear who's going to be next. You're outspoken, you have a clear position, and so on and so forth. But we didn't. It was technically difficult to pack three kids, so we stay in Kiev. And then our daughter, who's 19, and she's a second-year student at the university, at the very last days of the revolution, she was, I don't know if you remember the chronology, but the snipers were already there, and they were taking people down randomly. And then we figured that our second 19-year-old daughter is there as well, and we forced her back home and used all our parental resources to keep her home. And then suddenly, Yanukovych fled, and the whole thing, we thought that the whole nightmare is over. Yanukovych fled to Russia, but then a few days afterwards, Russia annexed Crimea and started the whole infighting in the east of Ukraine. And then we all were back to our news wires, waking up at night and in the morning and checking, maybe Russian troops gonna be here in, you know, in a couple of days. And but as I said, it's been a year since my life turned into a emergency mode, and the crisis is still underway in Ukraine, but there are some positive achievements as well. One of them is that Yanukovych fled to Russia along with his friends, and those people who actually kicked me out of the magazine, lots of other journalists. Free media in Ukraine is now possible. I found a new investor, and we launched a new weekly magazine, which I hope will be better than one before, with ambition of becoming one of the most popular in the former Soviet Union. And a new site, accommodating 55 independent journalists now. And meanwhile, my wife gave birth to two beautiful twins, a boy and a girl, named Peter and Anne. And I hope when Peter and Anne turn 16, they'll be living in a totally different country and facing way easier challenges that we have been over the last 12 months. And that's what it's been all for, if you ask me.
That's great. Well, thank you very much, and thank you for coming. So, Viktoria, you've been at the eye of the storm, working for the interim president and now the speaker. Bring us up to date, literally, from a half hour ago, okay? What is unfolding right now in Kiev and in Ukraine?
Actually, if we have before two revolution, it's for me, because this anti-colonial revolution, it was anti-Russian revolution, actually, because we don't be a Russian, you know, a Russia, so it's a big challenge for Ukraine to be another country, to be European country, to be liberal country with another values. But now, today, we have a war, really. This hybrid war, which started Russia against the Ukraine,
it's a new term invented by Russians.
Yeah.
Hybrid war.
Yeah. It's war very strange. It's war on the different fronts. It's a media front, for example, because propaganda, sometimes Russian propaganda, it's very funny because, you know, it's a myths. It's nothing in reality. So no facts, just only something unbelievable. I don't know about which country they said, but they said it about Ukraine. One example, just one example, when we had the presidential election, Russian TV said that the most popular politicians in Ukraine is the leader of radical right sector organization, and that he has the 30% of support. It was totally a lie because, you know, he has 1% of support.
Even less than 1%, yeah.
Yeah, less than 1%. But they said it, you know, so that's only one goal. It's nothing true. And propaganda, it can be funny, but when the people die, it's not funny. Because, you know, it's just only do this conflict hot inside Ukraine. The second front, of course, in international relations front. Because you know that Russian can buy a lot of politicians in Europe, in other countries. And it's a very strong conflict between our rights and international relations and international support, of course, because we need this support. So Russia much more bigger and much more stronger countries. It's also the truth. And of course, also I have to say about military front, because the biggest troops which are now in the east of Ukraine, it's mercenaries from Russia. So they have a Russian military equipment, they have a Russian weapon, they have a Russian money, and that's a big problem for us. But we understand that now it's a war for independence of Ukraine. Because Ukraine can be sovereign country only in that case if all of us, Ukrainian people, can keep our country in this border. I think it's very important for us, and of course it's very important for all system of international security. Because if Russia can give some Ukrainian territory, so the international agreements, the international security system, it just only papers, but nothing in reality.
Vitaly, that's very helpful.
I'll add a little bit, because you asked what's actually going on now.
Yeah. Then I have a specific question
I just,
for you.
Yeah. I just checked the wires this morning.
Yeah.
I mean, in Kiev, where we come from, it's all
in
quiet.
Kiev, because people here don't...
Kiev is the capital, everybody knows, I think.
In
Kiev, it's now all quiet. Yeah. It's tense, but there's nothing going on. But in the east of the country, there is heavy fighting going on. There's Ukrainian troops, and there is the so-called, the Russian TV calls them rebels, we call them separatists or terrorists.
Yeah.
It's about 15,000 of these people. We believe it's about 4,000 Russian militants with combat experience from Chechnya, Afghanistan. Lots of them were conscripted through conscription points in Russia, which in my mind is a direct evidence of the Russian government involvement.
Yeah.
Then being transported via the border to Ukraine, equipped with Russian weapons and funded and so on. So there's about 4,000 of these people. And there's about 10,000 of local Ukrainians. Some of them have been there for money. Some of them have been there sincerely, we have to admit them. Some of them have been made to believe that all of their economic hardships have been part of the Kyiv policy, which is not true. I think a lot of them were subject to Russian propaganda, because if you know, east and south of Ukraine are Russian speakers. I'm a Russian speaker too. And if you watch a Russian TV, they don't have Ukrainian television now, because the Russians have cut it off. So if you watch a Russian TV, if I watch Russian TV, I want to take a machine gun and start killing those Nazi Ukrainians immediately. So it's quite emotional and quite effective. So the at this point, the Ukrainian troops have stopped the ceasefire, and there is heavy fighting going on in the east.
One of the things that I really learned from visiting, and Vitaly was the author of really my favorite quote from my visit to Ukraine.
Buffer zone?
We were talking, and he said, "Who said I have to be part of Putin's sphere of influence?" And it was just such a simple question, but it really framed for me what this war symbolizes, which is, this is really a 19th century view of the world versus a 21st century view of the world. 19th century, I have my sphere, I'm Russian,
right.
I am big, I have spheres of influence, and you too must be in my sphere of influence. Versus what I would call a 21st century view of spheres of influence versus people of influence. Now you have people of influence, these emergent citizens. Talk about that a little bit more. What was going through your head?
I've been always amazed when I heard, even in the States or in Western Europe, a point that, look, I mean, Ukraine is a buffer zone of Russia. Well, it's a sphere of interest, so let's skip it to Russia. We shouldn't interfere. But has anybody asked us whether we want to be a buffer zone? Do we have a right for self-determination? We believe we do. And we don't want to be Putin's buffer zone, influence sphere. So that's what actually happened. The people realized that the protest in Kyiv was extremely diverse, right? It united lots of people, advertising agencies, media, businessmen, just regular poor people from Western Ukraine and Southern. So it was really big. And the people just realized that they do not want to be live in the post-Soviet Ukraine. They don't want to live with the same values that they have in Russia. We don't want to have a one-party system. We want to have political competition. We don't want to have state government-owned propaganda. We want free media. We want personal and economic freedoms. It's as simple as that. And in that way, if Russia does not support these values, then we want to stop being part of Russian sphere of influence, and we want to start moving westward. And the driving engine between this were the creative class, the people of Ukraine.
Yeah. So let me just frame the question for you, and you can give whatever answer you want. But because I look at Putin now, and I can't tell whether he's felt he's got a perfect strategy, which is just to keep Ukraine boiling, maybe forever, just so you can't settle down.
That's one
other possibility, I say to myself, is that he's actually put himself up a tree. On the one hand, he unleashed these rebel forces into eastern Ukraine, and actually discovered that even in eastern Ukraine, people feel Russia's a nice country to visit, but I wouldn't want to live there, you know? That he's not as popular as he thought. And at the same time, it does seem that the Germans, the French, and the Americans have said to him, one more move, and we will have no choice but to ratchet these sanctions up. So he doesn't want that. So he's trying to figure out, I unleash this, I don't want the sanctions, but if I now calm it down at home, people will say, what a wimp you are. You backed down. So what is your analysis of him? Is this a clear strategy, or is he now up a tree?
So, sometimes I want to say thank you, Vladimir Putin, mm-hmm. Because nobody do much more for Ukrainian independence than he did, that he does. I'm sure that Ukraine, after this story, never been a part of something like Soviet Empire, which Vladimir Putin tried to restart just now. Why? Because my daughter, she is 11 now, she hates Russians. It's a bad feeling, you know? So I tried to told her before that, we are not brothers, like as Russian propaganda said us all this time, you know, so Ukraine and Russia had brothers, people, every time it was like this. All Ukrainian new generation understand that we have the another values just now. We want to have the another countries. But Vladimir Putin, he tried to do some strong state, and new values, new Russian Orthodox values. Because, it's not the conflicts between Russia and Ukraine. That's a conflict between real values, Western liberal values of people dignity, of freedom, and this Putin's ideology of some kind of Russian values, specific Orthodox values against the homosexuals. It's something very bad for Russian people and something very terrible for them, because it can be the part of their natural values. And now I think that strategically, Putin really falls down.
Why do you say it? In what way?
Because we have the challenge to create a new country. And if we will do it, and I believe that we will do it, it will be end of Russia of Vladimir Putin. Because it will be good example for Russian people that people can do a great role in political life. They can decide a lot, not just only one person who decide what to do. Yanukovych also thought that he can decide that Ukraine will be in the Russian sphere, and he took the money from Vladimir Putin and everything will be okay. And Ukrainian people said, no, so we are not agree with you. Who are you, guy? And now he's in Rostov, not in Russia, so not in Moscow.
Yes.
So Vladimir Putin gave them the opportunity to do the press conference in Moscow.
Yeah.
Who are you? Asked him, Vladimir Putin. So, and I'm sure that Russia also will have a big transformation ahead. And Ukraine is only start this post-Soviet transformation in the Eastern Europe.
I'll just add a little, I think, funny example on the consolidation effect that Putin has had on Ukraine. You probably know the World Cup is going on in Brazil, and some teams are out, as well as Russia. Russia's last match was against Algeria. And somebody conducted an opinion poll in Ukraine and asking people, so who you're going to support in the game. And only 5% said they're going to support Russia and 95% said Algeria. My wife, once she heard the results, she said, who are those idiots 5% supporting Russia? We don't trust this opinion poll. Yeah, as my Jewish friend in Kyiv put it, it's like never, ever so many Jews have supported the Arabs as in this last particular game. Yeah.
Interesting. Talk a little bit, though, about why the EU agreement is so important. What you're going through reminds me of something I've seen before, and I call it globolution. That is, when you cannot generate the revolution for economic and political reform from within, from below, and you cannot get it from above, you look for it from beyond.
Right.
And so much of the desire to have this EU association agreement is not just about trade, that I can export this or that for a lower tariff. It's actually about importing value standards, regulation, transparency. Talk about that. Why this agreement is so important.
First of all, the EU agreement is a starting point. Is a starting point for transforming the economy. What is the EU agreement? It's a set of commitments and obligations that Ukraine is taking, and it has to fulfill, like over 10 or 15 years, period of time. And a lot of them are connected to reorienting our exports to the East European Union from Russia. A lot of it means upgrading the industry, cutting down on energy inefficiency, cutting down on red tape, cutting down on corruption, putting in order the courts, and lots of other things. So the EU agreement is a starting point of a long way that Ukrainians believe will, in 10 to 15 years, take them to Europe in not some kind of abstract way, but will rebuild the country in a way that will become much more European than it is now.
People don't realize, too, that per capita income in Ukraine is about a quarter of what it is in Poland all these years later. So, Viktoria, let me ask you this. So you alluded to this is our third revolution. I mean, in many ways, your first revolution, you know, people joke to me when I'm in Kiev, you got it because three guys got drunk in a forest, basically. You got independence. And talk a little bit about that back in 1991. Then there was the Orange Revolution. You guys gave us color revolutions, I think, was the first. And that fizzled out. Why should we believe, and I've had American officials say this to me, why should we believe that the third time is the charm? Why should we believe, why should we invest in a country where the elite ripped off the country at an industrial scale? The corruption of the oligarchs of Ukraine was industrial size. Why should we believe this time it's for real?
We cannot choose this time, you know, it happened. And you can be ready, when we came on Maidan, it's the first day, we really didn't know how many people will be there in that time. And I told you about two revolutions, anti-colonial and also bourgeois revolution. Yeah. So we really had the bourgeois revolution on the last half of year, because we have the middle class who are not agree with the rules of the game in economy, on politics, in the court system, justice system, and this middle class, this businessman, they really support the revolution. So they were a very important part of this revolution because that people who are interested in a new country, in this new condition for development.
And that's
of the
different
country.
From the Orange Revolution.
Yeah.
In what way?
I think that just now we have much more information what we want to have, you know, from the state. And our demands from the politicians are much more strong, you know, so we really understand that we have to finished the oligarch system in economy. It's very difficult, you know, because they are very strong guys. So they have money, they have media, they have some military regiments also. But the society has the agreement that we need a new economy system. Now we have the war, and that's not the first question for our schedule, you know. After the war, it will be the most important thing, how to organize a new political system and new economical system.
So let me just frame this, if I could. Because I one of the things I heard when I was there is we made a mistake in the Orange Revolution. We threw out the bad guys, that group of bad guys, right. And we turned over to a new group, and then we assumed they would perform and govern properly,
but
and
they didn't.
So what is civil society doing this time around, the press, NGOs, to ensure that this time they don't steal it away from you?
I think I'll maybe get back to your previous question as well, why this time is for real. I think the fact that several hundred people have been killed means a way higher responsibility for everybody. Mm-hmm. For a lot of people who are in the government, they understand. For a lot of people who are gonna control the people in the government, in 2004, after the Orange Revolution happened, everybody assumed it will just keep happening on its own, but it didn't. Yeah. Now everybody realizes that public control is important. Free media is important, NGOs are important, and control of these people are important. Now, a lot of people in the government, presidential administration, are the people we know personally. Yeah, it's like, it's difficult for them to keep looting the country. Well, keep, because they weren't there before.
Right.
They care about us, you know, we believe in ourselves.
Good.
Well, if you remember the story that I started with my co-owner who came down to Croatia, so he's now the head of presidential administration.
Interesting. Yeah?
The other co-owner is now a president, Petro Poroshenko.
Well,
I know these guys personally, and I do not believe that they will steal money.
He's also an oligarch.
Yeah. I think that the amount of extent of responsibility will be way higher, and extent of public control will be way higher. So it's a chance for success.
When I came to Kiev and I saw you last time, I was driving from the airport. I hadn't been there in many, many years. And the road took us through a forest. I was staying in the Maidan. And in the middle of the forest, I saw this brand new, huge building. And I said to the taxi driver, I said, "That looks like a museum. Is that like a new museum?" And he said, "No, that is the Yanukovych's helicopter pad." And it was a small airport, basically, that he insisted on building there.
This is one of the reasons why revolution happened as well.
Yeah.
Let me ask this. So you both have Russian friends. Everyone I talked to in Kiev, you know, we talked about talking to their Russian friend. When you talk to your friends in Moscow now, and you know the propaganda, Viktoria, you've alluded to it, they've been bombarded by. What is that conversation like?
It is difficult. My wife's sister is a Russian citizen. She's been in Moscow for 15 years or something. And she has personal contacts in Kyiv. So we call each other. She has an idea what's going on. But it's still difficult to convince people that what they see on TV five times a day is not true. Like people who've used to trust television believe, well, there must be at least 50% true of what they see.
Right.
And if you're a subject of such heavy bombardment, as you said, it's very difficult to reprogram people and reconvince them. So I've taken a personal stand. I've been in lots of verbal fights with Russians about what's actually going on in Ukraine. The key goal of Russian television has been to portray the anti-criminal, pro-democratic revolution as a Nazi coup sponsored by the United States. And they came there to basically kill anything that remotely resembles anything Russian, which is, of course, not true. So when Russians hear that 15 times a day, that this is an anti-Russian revolution, this is anti-Russian language and everything, they tend to believe at least some of it. And when you have a government control over television, it's difficult to believe. First, when 2 years ago, like a year ago, I was watching Russian TV and the news, I thought that this is an entertainment program. This is not the news summary. The amount of distortion, exaggeration, and just mere lies is incredible. Nobody's going to buy this. This is ridiculous. But then it stopped being funny when we realized it's actually very effective. And the reason is that 80% of Russians get all of their information from television.
With Putin, too, given his conspiratorial KGB background, there is no such thing as spontaneous in his world. Nothing is spontaneous.
Yes.
People do not have agency. Either the KGB or the CIA inspired them to do it. But the whole idea of the emergent citizen who has agency, herself or himself, is completely alien to him.
And it's hard to believe it as well. Yeah.
So let me ask you this before we'll go to questions. Viktoria, what is, sitting where you sit, you've got a lot of information about what's going on the ground in eastern Ukraine, in particularly the three most unstable provinces. How would you describe public opinion there? To what extent are there legitimate grievances? To what extent is this utterly the work of Russian inspired separatists? What is public opinion there? What's going on with the people there?
So you know, I think that now Ukraine is really united country, because we united against the aggressor. The situation on these two eastern districts, it's really very difficult because Vladimir Putin, you are absolutely right, he preparing this situation. So he creating his propaganda machine during 10 last years. He created Russia Today's and all this monopoly state system of information. Well, when some private channels is really the channels of Gazprom, not private. So as it's all only one machine of monopolize of information. And this channel were very popular in Ukraine because Viktor Yanukovych said that Russia is our big friends, and the people on the eastern regions, they really have a practice to see. And now the terrorists on this territory, they captured the radio system, and they switch off the Ukrainian channels, and the people on this territory also can watch on the Russian channels, and that's a big problem for us, you know. So because this propaganda and people believe believe in it. For me, the great example that my friend Yegor Sobolev, who was also one of the leader of the Maidan, he's Russian. And I know, you know, so I had a great support from the Russian people who live in Ukraine now. So they do a lot. They were the great volunteer to help the Ukrainian people against this Russian propaganda. And his parents, they live in Russia. He hadn't connection during half of year with him parents because they were sure that he is crazy. You know, that's also right. The example how it can work. Yeah.
So Vital, let me ask you this. How does this end well for Ukrainians? Because I totally agree with what Viktoria said, and I know you believe as well. This is actually all about domestic Russian politics. 90% of this is about Putin. And my view is that the country in the world Vladimir Putin threatens most is Russia.
And he knows why
he knows what this is about.
Yeah. So but nothing problem in Russia, just only Ukraine. Right. It's one problem for all Russia, you know.
But he's also very rich, very powerful, and you have, you know, people forget sometimes, you can't make this up. You have the former chancellor of Germany on the board of, you know, one of the biggest Russian oil companies in the world.
Sure, there you go.
Yeah, I mean, which is shameful, actually. But he's a rich, powerful guy. You are a small country, I had the fun experience of I went from Kiev to Hanoi, actually. And when you go from Kiev to Hanoi, it's very not directly through the States, but it's very easy. You see one mid-sized country up against a Russian bear that's looking for dignity in all the wrong places, to a mid-sized Asian country up against an Asian dragon that's looking for oil in all the wrong places. It's not easy, though, to be a small country next to a big, rich, powerful country. How do you win?
Well, you're right. I think Putin fears that revolution in Ukraine will be an inspiring model for a lot of Russian people to follow. And then if that happened in Ukraine, a country which is very similar to Russia, has the same background, historical, ethnic, and so on, then the Russians will understand that, you know, it's possible in Russia too, and he will lose all what you just mentioned, the money and everything. I think that the only way for Ukrainians to move forward is to try to end the war in the East, mobilize all the diplomatic and political support of our Western allies. There is no way we can do it otherwise. United States, what we figured is the biggest ally of Ukraine. Germany, United Kingdom, Poland may join too as well. And if we are in constant contact with our partners in the West, who, you know, pressure Mr. Putin to withdraw his troops, stop supporting the militants, stop equipping them with weapons and financing them, then there is a chance we can advance in the east of Ukraine, stop the war, and then eventually reform the country. That's also important. Ending a war is just one thing. Then we shouldn't waste the chance. We should just reform the country and move forward quickly, and I hope the country will be completely different 5 to 10 years from now.
Before we go to questions, why should Putin do that?
Well, I think Putin is even though he's quite spontaneous in what's been going on, I think he's able to calculate 2-3 steps mm-hmm. ahead. If the new wave of sanctions comes, I don't fully understand what it is. Mm-hmm. We've just heard it's so-called sectoral
sanctions.
Financial
banking. You know.
If it's, but what a sectoral sanction is, it varies, it may be yeah. different. If it's like a global embargo, let's say, on oil and gas, then you understand it's gonna be a huge blow to Russia, because a great chunk of its budget is sourced from oil and gas revenues. So Russia's gonna last for about, I don't know, 9 to 12 months, then it's gonna be huge popular discontent, because Putin's model has been dependent on convincing Russians that you live way better than many neighboring countries. And if that's the only thing that they have, it takes away the relative well-being of Russians, then he's gonna face a major popular discontent and uprising that may be worse than in Ukraine. So I think he's capable of calculating the possible consequences of sanctions and where he loses more and where he wins more. So that might be a reason why he would he may actually stop doing it without losing a face. That's actually another important question yeah. for Mr. Putin, because he now has about 80% of popular support in Russia. He has to explain somehow why he stopped doing that. He's not a weak guy. That's his key fear. He's like a strong, important guy, but he does it because there is an explanation, and he has to come up with one.
Yeah. Interesting. Let's open it to questions. I'm sure people have a lot. Just right here, in the middle, and right here, this young lady.
Thank you very much. When Yanukovych left, as Vitaliy said, all of us were very, very surprised by Putin's next play. Where do you all think he might go next? He has his hands full now. But his pattern has been clear for a long time.
It's a good question. The truth is that we don't know. What we hear is that he's in Rostov. He's not in high esteem in Russia for basically fleeing Ukraine. Somebody said he's in a resort town on the Black Sea coast, and somebody says that he actually acquired a mansion not far from Moscow, but we have no proof to that. At this point, he's in Rostov, and maybe he'll stay there for a while, hopefully.
Back there, all the way back. Bring the back row in.
How would you grade the U.S. Response to this, and how would you judge their ongoing relationship with Ukraine?
About sanctions, да, тобто?
Yeah.
That's a big question for us, why EU and USA are so slowly in the question of sanction. Because, we understand that for EU it's very important the some economy profits, and Russia is a really big country, and a big part of businesses, European businesses, are connected with Russian. But, now the Western countries must choose. What is important, economy profit or security? So now Russia and Vladimir Putin, it's a big dangerous, not just only for Ukraine. It's dangerous for all of Europe. Because the situation like is between the First and the Second World War. When we had the League of Nations, which was a very weak, and cannot do anything. And now the United Nations also very weak. So the Russia is a member of Security Council of United Nations, and this organization cannot do anything after Crimea story, So, and what I believe that the biggest power in the world is the people who believe in some ideas. What are doing Mr. Putin? His people believe in his ideas about this new ideology, about some specific Russian anti-liberal values. And these people believe in this. And that's really a big dangerous, because they demand of him to have a war with Ukraine, That's normal for Russia now. And I'm sure that Ukraine isn't not a stop for them. It's not a goal, So it can be shared to you.
Let me add on your question. I think U.S. has been the largest supporter of Ukraine. Kerry has been down in Kyiv. Joe Biden's been there, Victoria Nuland. I think United States have been instrumental in basically assembling support of other Western allies for Ukraine. So I think it's been a moderate, a driving engine behind Ukraine's efforts to consolidate the Western world and resist the Russian invasion.
And we need this third package of sanctions. It's very important just now, so.
Please.
My name is Diana Lady Dugan, and by way of disclosure, both my son and I were involved in the production of The Square, and I was...
The Tahrir Square, Square.
The Square, which is a Oscar-nominated film about the square in Egypt, Tahrir Square, although it was a Madan also, which is linguistically quite fascinating, as I think you pointed out. I also got very involved in enabling the screenings of the square in the Madan, and I know you've written quite a bit about this. So I've watched the media coverage quite a bit, and I have had the good fortune of getting a lot of feedback from not you all, but others there, and the really outstanding media in Ukraine, and Babylon 13, and all these groups that are writing.
Thank you.
And so I've been so blown away by how frankly imbalanced Western broadcasting has been about the coverage of Ukraine. I mean, whether it is not even saying, and I think the BBC has been the worst offender and we can guess why, but not even really saying that the referendum in Crimea was a Hobson's choice. And I wondered what you all have to suggest to counter that other than getting out more. And Tom, why do you think this has gotten beyond special interests?
Actually, the vote in Crimea, as I recall, the choices were, do you want to join Russia or do you really want to join Russia? I think that was the...
And then it's not clear who counts the ballots.
Right, exactly, yeah. So to talk about that, judge the Western media force. How does it look to you?
As I said, surprisingly, the Russian propaganda, if you want me to single out the most surprising aspect of the recent developments in Ukraine and Russia, I would name the efficiency of Russian propaganda. It's been effective not only in Russia, in parts of Ukraine, but also in Western Europe and in the United States. I think part of the reason is that people in the West find it hard to believe to what extent media coverage, you know, can reach. If you're a journalist, you're supposed to get both sides and to give both sides. And then you assume that the truth is somewhere in between. But when one of these sides is not a position, is not a collection of facts, but just making things up, then it just automatically pushes you a little bit toward the somewhere in between. That's my assumption. I have no explanation, justification for why a lot of media have been unable to get a real picture. I think another reason is that a lot of Western media corporations have their headquarters in Moscow as opposed to Kyiv. And they're affected by their friend circles. They're not on the ground. They don't know what's going on. They're affected by the environment. That's like, for example, The Economist has its correspondent in Moscow. It doesn't have it in Kyiv. So like a lot of German media will have it in Moscow, and they don't have it in Kyiv. So their vision is affected as well. Then also, if you watch the, for example, comments on CNN sites, financials, you would see a lot of pro-Russian comments, what we call in Russian bots. We believe these are not real commentators. There is like words of people near Moscow and St. Petersburg hired and paid money to type in lots of comments on the media sites in the United States, Germany, and Great Britain that are considered to be influential. And once you read a story, you continue reading the comments, and that affects your perception as well. So I think there is a major effort on the Russian side has been undertaken, and it's been quite effective even in the West, and that's quite sad.
You know, it's actually a lot like climate reporting. You know, some say, you know, the world's warming, some don't, and so some news outlets report both sides, but in fact,
For an hour we talk about Russian propaganda as an abstract notion. Let me give you an example of one episode of media coverage. One of Russia's largest channels, NTV, shows a lady who lives in Donetsk, that's where all the fighting in eastern Ukraine is going on, that goes supposedly into hiding in her basement of the building to hide from the carpet bombing of Ukrainian aviation. Then the Ukrainian journalist looked and said, this could not be possible to happen. Our aviation could not be bombing residential buildings. Then the people found this lady. She actually lives 300 miles away from the military zone. She lives in a peaceful area. And the reason that, you know, she showed them into the basement, because she's poor. She didn't realize, you know, how it will end up. She showed them the basement. So this is my basement, and so on. They paid her. And then eventually they made a totally made up thing. They broadcast 16 times on Russian television, then in Russia Today. And then you look at it, and it's very emotional, always, you know, with Russian anchors and so. You look at it, oh my God, these bloody Ukrainians are bombing residential buildings. And this poor lady went into the basement to hide from carpet bombing. But she actually lives in a different region. So that's just one example.
Yeah, and
there are dozens of those.
I would add that this is the big lie. This is not a small lie. I like to think of myself as fairly restrained in my calm, but I refer to it as Putin's Goebbels-esque, you know, lie. This is a huge lie. And it's hard for us to accept that in the 21st century that there's as big a lie being perpetrated as Putin is perpetrating right now. It's not that Russia doesn't have interest. It's not, I was against NATO expansion. It's not that I'm insensitive to economic, and the Ukrainians aren't ready to negotiate all of those. But the other thing is, I really found, you know, for me, going to Kiev was essential, because you do have to sit across from someone like Vitaliy and have him say, who said I have to be in Putin's sphere of influence? Until you actually have a human being say that to you, you realize stories operate under something called the superstory. So the superstory sets the frame. And the superstory of Russia and Central Europe is that Russia is a big power and it has spheres of influence. That's deeply embedded in our psyche. And only when you go there and you then start to question, wait a minute, who said, and what is that about? Anyways, back there, yeah.
So it's also the question of big money, of course. You know, it's a question of big money of course. So
and
it's very expensive system.
I think you guys, just one second, were unprepared to the fact that the media can be just pure lie. We were unprepared, but now we are prepared. Now we know. Now we filter when we watch TV. So I think that realization is still coming on in the United States and in Western Europe.
My question is the Crimea takeover a fait accompli? Is there anything that you are going to be trying to do? And how does this affect the future economy of the Ukraine?
You want me to start?
Yeah,
I think realistically, for now, I don't see how Crimea can get back into Ukraine for the foreseeable future. But as Poroshenko told me, the new president, he said that we have to reform the country and raise the living standards to an extent that will be an example that the Crimeans will envy us. Because one of the reasons why there was pro-Russian sentiment in Crimea is that, you know, pensions and state salaries are high in Russia, so that was one of the reasons why people wanted to join Russia. Not all of them, but some of them. So when an average salary in Ukraine will be double that of Russia, I think there will be a reverse referendum in Crimea. We went back to Ukraine. Yeah, but
Ukrainian politicians and Ukrainian people, we believe that Ukraine will be the part of Ukraine. Because, you know, in Crimea, there are a lot of new generation people also. They want to believe in the open world, in the global world. They can use an internet, and they also want the another standards. It's also, you know, the conflicts of generation, because old generation who lived in the Soviet Union, they really have some nostalgia from Russia and about Russia. But a lot of students there now in Crimea, they do a very interesting action about support of Ukraine, and they said us that we would like to be the part of the you know, not just Ukraine, but another country, not Russian style country. And that's, I believe that it can be.
Yeah. So. And I think we're discussing these scenarios of Crimea's future, given that Putin is the president, but he's not gonna be there forever. Once Putin is gone, what's gonna happen to Crimea? That's an open question.
Herbie.
To what extent or desire United States involvement, and how do you see that, thank you, manifesting itself? And if Putin
meets your cause with more resistance, to what extent do you expect America to play a role in responding to that resistance? Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So, if sanction will be on this level, what we have just now, Russia can exist in this situation just 5, 6, or 7 years.
Under the current sanctions.
Yeah. But if we will have the third package, the Russian will have money just only for 6 or 9 months. Now it's important because the economical influence is very important how to stop the aggression. It's the first thing. And the second thing, of course, we need a military support, you know. So that's true, because now we have just have only dry food from USA, but we need the armor, we need the weapon. That's also true, because, you know, Ukraine never had a war. It's a new practice for us. So we don't have an experience. We didn't have army 3 months ago. When after Maidan, we asked the Minister of Defense how many people are in Ukrainian army. He said 6,000. And how many Russian troops are in Ukrainian border, near the Ukrainian border? 100,000 Russian troops, you know, near the Ukrainian border. And we create a new army just now from volunteer. A lot of businessmen go to army now because they understand that all our future depends on this, and military support is also very important.
My understanding is the military involvement of the United States is now not a question from discussions with the U.S. Embassy in Kyiv as well, but a threat of sanctions and a realistic threat of sanctions, I think, can be quite instrumental. Russians should understand it's not a bluff. If they keep doing what they're doing, sanctions will be there. And I think that's a message that we would expect from the United States.
We got to close, so I want to ask you both a question, but what happens if Putin turns off the gas?
I think he already has.
I mean, in the winter, what happens? What will Ukrainians do?
It's a good one. I mean, the question. Ukraine was partially dependent on Russian gas. So basically, what Putin does, he forces Ukraine to diversify the sources. One of the key sources is the so-called reverse gas supplies, basically pumping natural gas from Slovakia and Hungary. That's going to cover a big gap. Hmm. Another one is boost local production. That's also possible. Sometimes with the help of American companies, shale gas, sometimes locally. That's another thing. I mean, from 3 to 5 years perspective, there is a chance that Ukraine can do without Russian gas at all. And that would eliminate a huge lever of influence of Moscow over Kyiv. But in the short period of time, we have enough gas to last till winter. That's what's going on right now in reserves.
Are people, Viktoria, I'll let you close. Are Ukrainians ready for the level of economic hardship and sacrifice that would be involved, assuming Russia maintains a hostile situation and doesn't just cut off gas but blocks exports and from Ukraine, et cetera? Are people ready?
So Ukrainians know that we will have a very cold winter. So, and we're ready because, you know, we understand that that is only one way to the real independent, the energy independent from Russia, and a quick step how to have another delivering way for energy resources.
I think one good thing that Putin has done, he's consolidated Ukrainians for unpopular reforms. Mm. I mean, when you do painful, unpopular reforms, you always need support of the people.
Right.
Otherwise, you get popular discontent, you get another uprising. Yeah. Now people are ready for hardships. How long it's going to last, I don't know. As of July 1st, for example, gas prices for residential and warm water and heating are up 55%. That's a lot. 55% is a lot. But I think people's going to take it. If they see that there are reforms, that Ukraine is moving in the right direction, that the sacrifice is not in vain, I think Ukrainians can accept that. And if they see that, you know, the sacrifice is wasted.
We never had a revolution about economical reason. We had the revolution about values all three times. Yeah. So,
you know, it's the first time that the two of you are here, and you should know that the best compliment you can get as panelists is when a meeting like this ends and there are 20 people who still have their hand up. So thank you very much.
Thank you.